I spoke with Justine Greening. She was a Conservative MP until Parliament was dissolved on Wednesday. But the Conservative Party had kicked her out earlier this year, removing the whip from her because she wouldn't vote in line with the government's Brexit policy, and she announced that she wouldn't stand in the next election. So she's finished out this parliamentary session as an independent. And in today's debrief, I asked her if she knows who she'll be voting for on December the 12th.
I want to see what they are offering our country. I care passionately about social mobility. I want to see what they are going to talk about in terms of how they plan to have a government that can transform social mobility. So, yeah, I'm certainly not going to be finalising my decision until we get towards the end of this election and I actually see how these parties have performed.
How surprised are you by that? You've been a Conservative Member of Parliament for Putney since 2005, I think, and to be in this situation now where you're not sure who you're going to vote for, is that not very strange to you?
Well, it is in a way, but I think because of Brexit, nothing feels quite the same in British politics. So I've obviously had very profound differences with my party on the route forward on Brexit. I'm someone who campaigned for Remain and wants to see a referendum. So I recognise I don't own the Tory party. It's gone off in a different direction, one that I don't agree with. But this election is a general election. It's not a referendum. So there's a domestic policy. My politics are broadly probably where the Conservative Party remains on domestic policy. And that's why I think, like millions of voters around Britain, I have to weigh it all up, because there'll be lots of us who are probably looking at all of the parties and thinking, well, I'm not sure quite any of those particularly marry up with where they lie on their politics.
This last parliament that's been dissolved now has been referred to as many things. Geoffrey Cox, the Attorney General, called it the dead parliament. The new Speaker, Lindsay Hoyle, said that it had tarnished Parliament in the eyes of the British public. What was it about these last couple of years that has led to that toxicity and to that even more polarised nature?
I think, first of all, it is this issue about the fact that people voted for Brexit, but the Brexiteers then argued about what Brexit meant. And we saw Boris Johnson, of course, leaving cabinet, campaigning against Theresa May's deal as a backbencher. And then, of course, still now Nigel Farage going into a general election saying he doesn't think Boris is delivering the real Brexit. So that was part of the problem. But I also think it's how we've had that debate and the steady reduction of respect, in a way, within Parliament for people of different views. My community is in London, Putney. It was 70-odd% Remain. And there's, I think, genuinely been not enough tolerance and listening to that 48% of the country that clearly felt we were better off staying in the EU. I think the big mistake that perhaps governments have made is to try and airbrush those concerns out of the picture instead of trying to build a coalition to understand what they were right from the word go, and then genuinely trying to find an approach on Brexit that could bring the maximum number of people with it. And I think, in a sense, that's where Parliament got stuck in a way, because it became a polarised discussion in Parliament, and that then almost entrenched those divisions that were there from the beginning, really.
Some of your female colleagues who have made the decision to stand down have cited as their reasons for doing so the intimidation and abuse that they've received. Can you describe for our viewers what it is actually like to experience?
Well, I think I've had less of that to deal with than other MPs. But in terms of what I've had to deal with, yeah, absolutely. I've had death threats. The kind of emails you get into your office, the kind of tweets that people put out at you are really aggressive. And I think what's concerned me about Parliament, in a sense, is that the public have kind of taken their cue from the way the debate's been handled in Parliament, and that aggression that we've seen in Parliament has come back to us. And I think it's really been focused often at female MPs. And I know that for many of my colleagues, although this is not at all why I'm moving out of Parliament, I think for many, many female MPs, it's become something that they've become really concerned about. And certainly when they think about what they want to do over the next 5 years, I'm sure it has factored in their decision-making in some cases.
Why do you think that female MPs in particular have become a lightning rod for those frustrations?
It's hard to say, other than perhaps people may tend to pick on the MPs that they feel maybe look almost more vulnerable as a woman in politics. And of course, some of the people who've had the maximum abuse are some of the toughest cookies I know, like Jess Phillips. You know, they're amazing advocates. But I think, yeah, I think there are some blokes probably who feel they don't want to hear a woman talking tough and being strident, and maybe that makes them feel threatened. I don't know, but I think it is something that we genuinely need to address. But that leadership on the debate needs to come from the top, including the Prime Minister.